On the other hand, foods such as milk, eggs, chicken, and other product, animal product may worsen the symptoms of this disease. The best long results in this chronic baffling disease are seen in people who are willing to adopt a diet that is free from animal product. Despite that, there are many forms of arthritis, including some related disease such as chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. The following general principles are effective in treating most cases. Normalizing your weight is extremely important because every pound counts. It increases the wear and tear of your the main body joint, like the knees, hips, and the spines. A largely plant-based diet, which is low in fat and high in fibers, has been shown to improve circulation. In time, this kind of diet may help open up some of the narrowed arteries, because fat thickens the blood and it slows down the circulation. And fat also causes red blood cells to stick to each other, so they have a hard time navigating those small arteries in our body, and they don't get to the specific joints in our fingers. Eliminating fresh foods, eggs, and dairy products can result a surprising amount of improvement in all these diseases, especially rheumatoid arthritis. Physical activity helps to supply nutrients to cartilage and strengthen your ligaments and muscles and joints. It also helps prevent stiff joints. Physical activity is extremely important in preventing chronic disability. When you are having a painful joint, considering contacting your doctor or your primary care physician and ask for a referral for a physical to see a physical therapist and ask about an alternative forms of exercise which may be more appropriate for you. For example, swimming is good for painful joints. Exercises also prevent to control weight, and is beneficial in preventing disease such as diabetes, heart disease, and cancer. A few minutes of sunlight a day is good, especially when your joints are painful, because it heals, it aids the healing process. Drink plenty of water, like 8 to 10 glasses of water a day is an ideal amount of water to keep our bodies healthy. And it also helps our joints lubricated. Occasionally, when the joints become so damaged that a person can no longer be active or independent, you can also ask your doctor, or your doctor can also advise you about a possible surgical procedures such as joint replacements that may also help you to regain your mobility. A close relationship with others, cheerfulness, joy, laughter, and especially faith in the divine power all promotes healing. This was a wise man summed it up as well, and it says in Proverbs 16:24, pleasant words are honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. Fight for your health, stay active. Most people who get better are the ones who take an active role in bringing about positive, permanent changes in their lifestyle. It's never too late to start. Thank you for listening.
We would like to thank Richard. Actually, Richard is a physical therapist, so he knows what he's talking about. Now, partner, we have our questions now. Is now the chance to get prizes?
Right.
No. So I'll ask the question.
You ask the question.
Yeah, you watch who raise their hands first.
I watch who gonna raise their hands first. Okay. Not only raise their hands, but they have to say the right answer.
Yeah, the right answer. Yeah, but we will ask them to give the answer once they raise their
okay.
hands first.
Okay, all right. So I hope you will get this right.
From the lecture last night, the first question is, what manner of event will the coming of Christ be so that you won't miss it? You can name two. Carlos? Yeah, earthquake. That's correct.
That's one.
That's one. Any other? But we can just. We only need one.
Oh, you only need one?
Yeah.
One out of six?
Out of six, we only need one.
All right.
Yeah, earthquake. What are the other answers? Carlos, you come here. You claim your. What are the other five?
Out of the six.
Out of the six.
Earthquake.
The first one mentioned was it
earthquake.
Is?
Earthquake.
No? It is a visible event.
Oh, visible, yes. Visible.
The second, it was a. It is a.
This gentleman, he wants to answer. He will not come alone. Yes.
Yeah?
That's true. Because Jesus will bring his angels. Carlos, you choose from this one. It's all good, man. Everything is good. He's looking for a Bible.
It's after the 20th night.
There's no Bible there, but I can give you one. Oh, that one is good. That one. No. The Great Controversy. Story time. Do you have kids?
No.
Oh, wait, that's not. This one is better, man. That one. That one is good. I'll recommend that one. If you have kids, I'll give you the story time. But since you don't have kids.
All right.
Okay, the second question is, what climactic event will happen when Christ returns? You know,
is that different from the first one, right?
It's different from the first one, but it's part of, you know, we part can of, name it as a part of the six.
Okay.
What climactic event will happen when Christ returns?
Your friend beside you raised his hand earlier. Yeah. Oh yeah, they can see from east to west.
No, it's not the thing.
It's not that one?
Actually, I'm trying to base my question from the handouts that were given.
Oh, okay. All right.
Oh, okay. It's not the answer I was looking for. Yeah, that this a hand there. Thank you. Anyway, this a hand there.
Huh? There will be a lot of antichrist. Is that the answer you're looking for?
No, it's not the answer. The dead in Christ will rise. It's based in 1 Corinthians 15.
Come here, ma'am. By the way, the keys yesterday are still here. Two Honda car keys and one Hyundai. You probably don't like your car, huh? Story time, that's... All right. Real story. So. They're very nice. Those are awesome stuff.
All right. Thank you. Yeah, it's now time for our...
So, if I were you, you should read the mind of Pastor because he has a very good questions. Because he wants to answer the way...
The key is kindly get a handout.
The handout, so it's easier that way, right?
Right.
They can study it.
Everything is in there.
Yes. So, all right, this question will be thrown to David. You ready?
By God's grace.
It's kind of tough, man. All right, you ready? According to Matthew 24, 40 to 41, isn't there a secret rapture in the end times? Oh, secret rapture.
All right, so last time we took a look at very clearly in the Bible that the Bible teaches that Christ's second coming is going to be anything but what?
Secret.
Anything but secret, right? But this thought of the secret rapture, they have twisted Matthew 24, and let's look at it for ourselves.
Yes,
go to Matthew chapter 24, and let's see what the Bible really says. Matthew, the 24th chapter, let's go to verse 40 is where they're asking us to read it. But if you read the context, it'll clear it up very, very quickly. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 24, notice in verse 37. Matthew 24, verse 37, here it is. Are we there, amen? The Bible says in verse 37, But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days of that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving into marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all, what everybody? Took them all away. So also shall the coming of the Son of Man be. So notice, Noah is in the ark. Who's being taken away? Is it Noah who's being taken away? Or is it the people outside the flood that are being taken away? It's the people outside the flood that are being taken away. So notice, that is the context that we find in verse 40. Watch this now. The Bible says in verse 40, then shall two be in the field. One shall be taken and the other what?
Left.
Left. Then two women shall be grinding at the mill. The one shall be taken, the other will be left. So notice, friends, in the context, is it better to be taken or is it better to be in the ark and stay there, be left? What's better?
Be left.
It's being left that's better, right? Those that were taken in the flood were the wicked. Are you with me? Those that were taken in the flood were killed, were destroyed. But those that were left in the ark, they survived. So it's better to be left behind, per se, than to be taken. Are you with me so far?
Yes.
We're going to dig this a little bit deeper. This is the only question that we got from last night, so I get to spend a little bit more time on this. Go to your Bible to Luke chapter 17. Luke, the 17th chapter. Luke chapter 17. Talking about the same thing. Let's go there pretty quickly. Luke chapter 17. Notice in verse 34. Luke chapter 17, verse 34. Notice what the Bible says. I tell you, in that night there shall be two men, one in bed, the one shall be taken, and the other shall be what?
Left.
Two women shall be grinding together, the one shall be taken, and the other what? Now notice what the disciples asked Jesus next. And they answered and said unto him, that's Jesus, where, Lord? He said unto them, whithersoever the body is, thither will the eagles be gathered together. So notice the question. The disciples are hearing Jesus says, one will be taken, the other shall stay. One will be taken, the other shall stay. And the disciples are asking, well, where? Where are they being taken? Are you with me? Where are they going? Where are they going? Where they're being taken? And the Bible says, Jesus says, wherever the body is, that's where the eagles will be also. Are you with me? So those that are taken, they are surrounded by what?
Eagles.
Vultures. Turn to your Bibles to Revelation 19. See this for yourself. Revelation, the 19th chapter. Revelation chapter 19, notice verse 17. This context is describing the second coming of Jesus. Revelation 19 is talking about the second coming of Jesus. The righteous are taken up to heaven, the wicked stay. But notice this in Revelation 19. Notice what the Bible says in verse 17. It says this, I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a what voice? A loud voice, saying to all the what? Fowls that were flying the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God. What happens to those that were taken? Those that were taken are taken by the birds, the vultures. When Christ comes back, many of all the wicked are going to perish, they're going to die, and the vultures are going to eat them. They're going to devour them. So friends, the context of the rapture, that one is going to be taken, the other's left, many people think that the ones that are taken, that's a good thing. But according to this context, those that are taken are those that are taken by the eagles. Those are the wicked. Those are the ones that suffered, just like it was in the days of Noah. Those that stayed in the ark were the ones that survived. Those that were taken by the flood were the wicked ones. Are you with me? So the secret rapture, first of all, we took a look at it last night. It's not biblical whatsoever. And where they gather it from, they're taking it out of context. And by God's grace, we've gotten it a little bit clearer tonight.
Amen. So we encourage everybody to ask questions. You can text it to that number on the screen, 909-283-0942.
Or
you can email it
to
thedawning.org. Org, yes. At this point, we're going to hear a special
number.
yes,
from Georgette Datan Sakai. Thank you for coming, Georgette.
When the valley is deep, when the mountain is steep, when the body is weary, when we stumble and fall, when the choices are hard, when we're battered and scarred, when we've spent our resources, when we've given our all, in Jesus' name we press on.
Music, huh? I am blessed. I praise God that we have such talent here. Amen? Amen. If one of you guys, I don't know about you, but this is the songs that we hear just before the messages. Just, don't they prepare your heart for hearing God's word? Amen? I know it does for me, and I'm thankful that God has blessed these young women and men to share their talents for the Lord. God gives you gifts to use for His glory. Amen? Amen. God has given you abilities. He's given all of us talents. The Bible says that some person may have one, some person may have two, some person may have five. But the Bible says you have a talent, and we are to use it for the Lord. And when we do, the Bible promises that He will multiply them. So if you only have one talent, don't worry. God will multiply it, and soon you may have 10 talents before you even know it. Amen. So just continue to use it for the Lord, and God will bless you. Well, friends, I am very excited about tonight's topic. It is one that's near and dear to my heart. How many of you have ever lost a loved one? Anybody here? Ever lost a loved one? Is it sad? Is it painful? It is. For many of us, it is. This last year, we buried my aunt, my youngest aunt, and we buried my grandmother in the same year. And it was a tough experience for my family and I. But this message that I'm about to share with you tonight is going to give you hope, amen? It's going to encourage us that even though our family members may be separated, our loved ones may be gone, soon by God's grace we're going to see them again. So I pray that this topic tonight will encourage you and may inspire you to stay faithful to the very end, amen? All right, well, without further ado, I'm going to ask God to bless us in this message. So if you can with me, please bow your heads for a word of prayer. My Father, which is in heaven, Father, I thank you so much that, Father, in your word, we could press on. That through the grace of Jesus, we could continue moving forward. No matter how dark this world may be, Father, there is a dawning coming. Jesus Christ, in the darkest periods of our life, Father, He will always appear to give us hope if our eyes and our ears and our hearts are seeking after you, Father. I pray, Lord, that if there's anyone here that is in darkness, if there's anyone here, Father, that may feel that hope is slipping through their fingers, that tonight they will grab hold of the rising of Jesus Christ, that they will grab hold of the only hope that sustains through the darkest periods of this earth's history, and that is found in you. May you bless us tonight, I pray, in Jesus' name, amen. All right, tonight's sermon is entitled, The Loudest What, Friends? All right, you guys didn't sound like an alarm clock at all. Let's try this again. The loudest what, everybody? Alarm clock. The loudest alarm clock. What is the greatest expression of love that someone could show another person? Anyone know? All right, so nobody's in love with somebody here in this room. Okay. Yes, sir. This guy got it right on the dot. You die for them, right? Willing to die for the person. Notice what Jesus says. The Bible says in John 15:13, greater love has no man than this, that to lay down one's life for his what? For his friend. So God, Jesus Christ himself says, listen, the greatest way that you could show that you love somebody is when you're willing or when you die for that person. Has someone died for you, friends? Who is that person? Jesus Christ has shown us the greatest way or the greatest example of his love. He's demonstrated his love towards us. What is the greatest fear that you could think of today? What do you think people are most afraid of in this world? All right, I hear unanimously dying, right? They're fearful of death. They don't know what's going to happen. Now, why do you think death is so scary? Why do you think death is so scary? Pardon me? Separation of life, okay. Why is death so scary? You don't know where you're going, right? What's going to happen to me, right? That's obvious. Yeah, that may be a doubtful thought that's in your mind. Well, when did this fear enter the world? What happened in the very beginning when at the fall, when Adam and Eve decided to disobey God, and the Bible says that if you eat of this fruit, God told them, if you eat of the forbidden fruit, you shall surely die. They did it, and they were sent out of the garden, and soon after a number of years, they ended up dying. But the Bible says that it describes how death entered this world. And here it's how. The Bible says in Genesis 2, verse 16, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat of it, for in the day that you eat thereof you shall surely what, friends? you shall surely what? Die. So God says, don't eat of that fruit. The moment you eat it, the process of death is going to begin. You're going to die. Are you with me? But all of a sudden, someone entered the garden, the devil, and notice the first lie we read in the Bible, straight from the devil's mouth, notice what it's on. The serpent said to the woman, you will not surely what? So here's God, and God is saying, listen, you eat of that fruit, what's going to happen? You're going to die. Here comes the devil, and he says what? You are not going to what? Die. The first lie you ever see mentioned in the Bible is on the topic of what? Death. You're not going to die. But Adam and Eve did disobey God. The consequence was they had to leave the Garden of Eden. And notice what the Bible says. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to you. You shall eat of the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return unto the what? Unto the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and unto dust you shall what? You return. Many people are fearful of death. When they think about death, when they think about dying, they're afraid because they don't know where they're going to go. They don't know what's going to happen. The process of death is scary to them. Tonight we're going to find out what happens when someone dies. What does the Bible say? What happens when someone dies? Well, in order to understand what happens when someone dies, we have to recognize, well, how do we become alive in the first place? How do we become living beings or living souls? What are we made of? In order to understand death, we have to understand life, how God made us. And notice what the Bible says. And the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the what? Breath of life, and man became a living what? A living soul. Now, what makes up man is two things. You got the body, which is the dust out of the ground, the dirt, and you got the what? The breath of life, and that equals a living what? So you need two things in order to be alive. You need two things in order to be a person that's living, and that is what? The body, which is made up of the what? Dust of the ground, and what else? The breath of life. And that is what equals a living soul. Now, the word soul has confused many people, in fact, many Christians. Many Christians believe that when you die, your soul goes where? To heaven, or it goes straight to where? To hell, right? But notice, how does the Bible use the word soul? Is the word soul something that's invisible, that just floats somewhere? How does the Bible use the word soul? Now watch, this is going to be awesome. Notice what the Bible says in Acts. At Pentecost, they were baptizing many people. Notice this. Then they that gladly received his word were what? Baptized. And the same day, there were added unto them about 3,000 what, everybody? So how many people were baptized? 3,000 souls. So notice, the word soul is the same word as a what? Person. Exactly right. So how many souls are in this room? How many souls would you estimate? There's probably about 100 souls, right? About 100 souls in this room. This lady's counting right now. Okay, that's pretty cool. 100 souls, right? 100 people. Are you with me? Yes. How many of you are living souls right now? Some of you are dead souls. I don't know what's going on here. Yeah, all right, yeah, we're living what, everybody? So David Machado is a living soul. Yes, that is what a soul is. It is a person. Are you with me? Let's see some more examples. Let's see what the Bible says. The Bible says this. Paul was in a shipwreck, and in second to last chapters of the book of Acts, notice what it says. And we were in all in the ship, 216 what? Souls. So there was a lot. There was over 200 people in the ship. Are you with me? Yes. The Bible equates soul as a living person. Notice this. Behold, God is saying this. Behold, all what? Souls are mine. As the soul of the Father, so also the soul of the Son is what? Notice this scripture. The Bible says, the soul that what? Sinneth, it shall die. Watch this again. Another name for soul in the Bible is what? Person or life. Okay? Notice this. We've just read this verse. Notice what today's English version translates it. The what? The person who sins is the one who will die. So soul is the same word as a what, people? As a person, right? Soul, person, people, same thing. There is no such thing in the Bible as an immortal what? Soul. Only God is immortal. Let's see what the scripture says. Notice what the Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. It says this. Now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Notice this scripture right here. 1 Timothy 6. The King of kings and Lord of lords, who what? Only has what? Immortality. Friends, if you died and you continue to live, that would make you an immortal person. Oh, we're sleeping tonight. Got a bunch of dead souls here. The Bible says, I mean, if think about it, if I died and I continue to live somehow, my something was floating up in the air because we know it's not soul, that would make us an immortal soul. But the Bible says only God is what? Immortal. Only God is immortal. The Bible uses the word soul 1,600 times, and never once does it use the words immortal soul. A living person minus the breath of God equals a what? Corpse. Notice what the scripture says in Ecclesiastes 12, verse 7. Then the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who what? Gave it. So notice, the word spirit, we're going to find this out through the Bible also. The word spirit is the same word as breath. Are you with me? Watch this from the Bible. Notice what this says in Job chapter 27, verse 3. All the while, my what? Breath is in me, and the Spirit of God is where, friends? In my nostrils. So when God breathed into Adam the breath of life, that literally is the Spirit. It's the same word. So spirit and breath are the same thing. Let's keep going. Notice what the scripture says. In Psalms 146, it says this, put not your trust in princes, nor in the son of man, in whom there is no help. He is what? His breath or spirit goes forth. He returns to the earth in that very what? In that very day, his thoughts what? Perish. When you die, do you continue to think? Does somehow the spirit or soul go out everywhere and start thinking about this and that? No, the Bible says you stop thinking. Your spirit, the breath that God gave you, goes back up to God. It doesn't have a mind of its own. It doesn't have thoughts. It doesn't have feelings. It's gone. Are you with me? Let's keep studying. Watch this. It's going to be more clear as we go by. All right, this is going to be fun. The Old Testament Hebrew word for spirit is what? Nobody said it. Okay, it's a hard word and it sounds terrible, all right? Let me try this. The Hebrew word for spirit is rauk. All right, you got to say it with, all right, that's how they do it back there, all right? All right, ready? All right, yeah, let's, all right, no spinning though. All right, yeah, the Hebrew word for spirit is what, everybody? All right, someone over here got it. It's rauk. All right, rauk, which means what? Which means breath. All right, notice this. The spirit and soul are what? Different. A soul is what? That's me. Hello. I am a... No. That's right. I am a what? I am a soul. Amen. You guys got it. I am a what, everybody? I am a living soul. A spirit is something that makes up a living soul. When God... You need two things in order to be a living soul. You need what? The spirit or the breath and the body, which is the dust of the ground. The spirit or breath of life, the power of life, goes back to God. The Bible teaches that the breath and spirit are the same thing. Notice this. We read this verse again. Let's read it again. All the while my breath is in me and the spirit of God is in my nostrils. Notice this in James. For as the body without the spirit or breath is what? Death. You got to have both the body and the spirit or the breath, which is the breath, in order to have life. Are you guys with me? If you're with me, say amen. Amen. Is there any consciousness in death? Well, let's see what the Bible says. You're quick. Let's see it. Let's notice what the Bible says here. Ah, went too fast. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 5. For the living know that they shall what? Die. But the dead know not what? Anything. Neither have they any more reward. For the memory of them is what, friends? It's forgotten. Notice this, Psalms 115, 17. The dead praise. The dead what, friends? Praise not the Lord, neither any that go down into silence. That's kind of interesting. If I die, and if I went to heaven, do you think I'm going to be praising God? Come on. If I died and I went up to heaven, do you think I'm going to be praising God? Absolutely, right? I'm going to be excited, ecstatic. I'm in heaven. But the Bible says when you die, you're not praising. Your thoughts perish. Let's keep studying this. It's going to be powerful. Watch this. Job 14, 14. If a man die, shall he what? Live again. All the days of my appointed time will I what, everybody? Wait till my what? Change comes. You shall call, and I will what? I will answer, the Bible says. Notice this. Job continues. If I wait, the grave is what? Is my house. I have made my bed in what? In darkness. Notice, what Jesus is about to illustrate what we've been reading here. Jesus illustrates this in a story that death is really just a what? Watch this. Jesus had a good friend named Lazarus, and Martha and Mary were Lazarus' sisters. He had a great friend. And notice this, Jesus tells his disciples this. Our friend Lazarus, what? Sleeps. But I go that I may what? Wake him up. How many of you love being woken up? Taking a good nap? How many of you just enjoy being woken up? One person, two people? I know my dad loved it. And he's shaking his head right now. Absolutely not. As a kid, I always wanted to play. I would go wake up my dad. He's like, 10 more minutes, 20 more minutes, 30. I was like, oh, I can't handle this anymore. Yeah, Jesus is saying, I'm going to go wake up my friend what? Lazarus, I'm going to go wake him up. But notice, the disciples are thinking, man, Jesus, I thought you were supposed to be a nice guy. Notice this. Then his disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he will what? He will get well. What is wrong with you, Jesus? Let him sleep. But notice this. However, Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought he was what? Speaking about taking rest and sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. So notice, Jesus equates death as a sleep. As a sleep. He says this, and I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go to him. Let's continue. Then Martha, this is Lazarus' sister, said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have what, everybody? Would not have died. Jesus said to her, your brother will what? This is awesome, friends. Jesus is saying, yes, I know your brother's dead, but he's going to what? He's going to rise again. Notice this biblical response that Martha gives. Martha said to him, I know that he will what? Rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Biblical response. Martha says, yes, Lord, I know that he's going to rise again at the last day. When the trumpet sounds, when you come back and raise all those that are in the grave, I know that's going to happen. Notice Jesus' response. Jesus said to her, I am the what? I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall what? He shall live. So notice what Jesus does. Jesus goes to the tomb of Lazarus, and notice what he does. He says this, Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time there is a what, everybody? There is a stench, for he has been there how long? 4 days. But Jesus does something incredible. They move the stone, and Jesus says this. He cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, what? Come forth. Notice, Jesus didn't say, Lazarus, come down from heaven. He didn't say, Lazarus, hey, I'm going to take you out of hell. He says, Lazarus, there's the grave, come forth. Are you with me? Something amazing happened. Lazarus did come forth. Notice that this was a type of what's going to happen when Jesus Christ comes back at his second coming. At the second coming of Christ, Jesus is going to come, and the Bible says the dead in Christ are going to what? They're going to rise forth. It's going to be the loudest alarm clock anyone has ever heard, but it's going to be the most sweetest sound any one of us have ever heard if we die. Death is a state of perfect rest or sleep until the resurrection, when Christ wakes you up and says, now the sorrow is all over. Notice what the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 4. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no what? Hope. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a... I can't hear you. With a what? With a shout, there you go, with the voice of an archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise, what everybody? Rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the what? With the Lord. Friends, I want to let you know that when someone dies, they are just sleeping, waiting for Jesus to call them up. Amen? Amen. That's why the second coming is such a beautiful event, friends. The Bible says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, depicting of the resurrection. Notice what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51. It says this, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all what? Sleep, but we shall all be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the what? The dead shall be raised how? Incorruptible, and we shall be what? Changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Friends, when you come up, if you happen to die, when Jesus Christ calls you from the grave, you know what you're going to be doing? You're going to be coming out and singing. Oh, no one's excited about that. You're going to come out of the grave saying, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is your victory? Amen? Amen. But let me tell you something, friends. There have been deadly delusions all around us. The first lie ever mentioned in the Bible was on death, and this topic of immortality of the soul has been plaguing and deceiving millions of people around the world. You know, how many of you have heard of Shirley MacLaine? Shirley MacLaine believes in life after death. She believes this. Notice this. The fundamental principle of spiritism is that human beings survive bodily death, and that occasionally, under conditions not yet fully understood, we can communicate with those who have gone before. Watch this. They say there is no death in the graveyard. She says she has frequent talks with the dead. Interesting. In the Fox Sisters, that's where the birthplace of modern spiritualism all took place, with the Fox Sisters, on their tombstone, it says this, there is no death, they are no what? They're no dead. She says this, I believe that souls, invisible entities, are part of the cyclical harmony of nature. None of it ever what? Dies. It just changes form. So what does she basically say? You could continue to live. Are you with me? That's what she says. It sounds like something interesting. It sounds like the first lie we heard in the garden. Notice this. The Bible says, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which does what? Which deceives the whole world. Check this quote out, friends. Almost 70 million Americans say that they think it's possible to communicate with the dead. This is in People Weekly. This was done in 1999. Friends, I guarantee you that there's more today that believe that. How many of you know who this person is? Anyone know who this person is? No? This is Alex Malarkey. Alex Malarkey, about 7 years ago, maybe a little bit longer, he had a horrible car accident, and for 2 months he was in a coma. And after he came out of the coma, he claimed that he was in heaven. He was where, everybody? He was in heaven, and him and his father wrote this book that's entitled The Boy Who Came Back from Heaven. Notice this, though. Just this year, right in the beginning of this year, notice what happens. Originally published in 2010 and co-written with his father, Kevin, The Boy Who Came Back from Heaven purports to tell the story of Malarkey's encounter with miracles, angels, and life beyond this world. All right? After a car accident left the 60-year-old in a coma for 2 months, the book landed on bestseller lists and joined a growing canon of heaven tourism literature. This book has sold over 1 million copies. Over 1 million copies. Check what happened in the beginning of this year. I did not die. This is what he says, directly from what he says. I did not die. I did not go to heaven. I said I went to heaven because I thought it would get me attention. Notice this. When I made the claims that I did, I had never read the Bible. People have profited from lies and continue to. They should read the Bible, which is enough. The Bible is the only source of truth. Anything written by man cannot be what? This is powerful, friends. This young man sold millions of copies of his books, and finally he's gotten convicted as he's reading the Bible and as he recognized, listen, I am tired of profiting from my lies. I did not go to heaven. And if you read the Bible very clearly says that when you die, you don't go anywhere. You're in the grave. Are you with me? Powerful testimony, friends. Let's keep reading what the Bible says. The eye of him that has seen me shall see me no more. Thine eyes are upon me, and I am what? Not. Notice what Job is saying. As a cloud is consumed and vanished away, so he that goeth down to the grave shall come up what? No more. He shall return no more to his house, neither shall his place know him anymore, friends. The Bible's very clear. The Bible says that when you die, that grave becomes your what? Your home. You're sleeping. The Bible says very clearly, you're not going to go back and try to haunt your family. You're not going back to try to scare them or try to comfort them. The Bible doesn't teach such things. What happens after death? You yet shall be brought to the grave and shall remain in the tomb. The Bible says this. His sons come to honor, and he doesn't know it. They are brought low, but he perceives it not of them. When you go visit your loved ones at the grave, friends, they don't know that you're there. The Bible says they're sleeping, waiting for that great alarm clock. The Bible says this. For they are the spirits of devils, working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to battle of the great day of God Almighty. The Bible says this, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets and shall show great what? Signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the what? I want to show you a powerful text. Write this text down. It's found in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Notice this. Now the Spirit speaks expressly that in the last days or latter times, some shall depart from the what, everybody? Faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of what? What was the first doctrine or the first teaching the devil ever taught? The first teaching the devil ever taught was, you will not surely what? Die. Friends, I want to let you know something. That the devil is out there deceiving millions of people. The devil has power. The Bible says he has great signs and lying wonders to deceive us. Can I tell you a real story? Or are you guys too shocked for me to go keep going? You guys all right? I'm going to tell you a story. There was a pastor and his wife, and they had a little girl. A pastor and his wife, they had a little girl. They studied their Bible. One day, tragically, the little daughter was killed. She was outside playing, accidentally crossed the street, and she was hit. She died. The mother and the father were grieved. One day, after months after this happened, the father was out working, giving Bible studies. The mother was home alone. All of a sudden, the mother, as she's sitting there, hears something. Mama, Mama. She turns around, she's in the kitchen, she goes over to the hallway and sees her daughter. The daughter starts running towards her. Listen, friends, true story. The daughter comes to her, hugs the mother, and she could smell her, friends. She could hear, she could feel her. This is her daughter that she recognizes, and all of a sudden, as she's hugging, as she's caressing this young girl, her baby, all of a sudden, all these texts that we study in the Bible hit her in the head and said, wait a minute, Lord, this is not what your word says. This is not what the Bible teaches. And all of a sudden, she said a quick prayer and said, Lord, if this is not you, please take this away. And immediately when she said that, vanished, was gone. The devil has power to deceive, friends. I see it all over. I could tell you stories upon stories. I've had encounters with people who've told me such stories, friends. But the Bible never lies. Where do the dead go when they die? Well, the Bible says this, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the graves shall hear his what? Shall hear his voice. They shall come forth, the Bible says. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. The Bible says that everyone will be in the grave until God calls them. Some to the resurrection of life, friends. Some to the resurrection of damnation. Martin Luther believed this because he believed in the Bible. We shall sleep until he comes and knocks on the little grave and say, Dr. Martin, get up. Then I shall arise in a moment and be happy with him. For what? Forever, the Bible teaches. Well, some people say, well, what about the thief on the cross? Got you there, David. What about the thief? He went to paradise. He went to heaven. Notice this. And he said unto the Lord, Jesus, one of the thieves on the cross that was right there with Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto you, today shalt thou be with me where? In paradise. I want you to understand something very clearly tonight. The Bible was not written with punctuation. It was added centuries later by the medieval church. All right, so the commas, the periods, the exclamation marks, the colons, that's not necessarily inspired. Are you with me? That was added centuries later after the Bible was done. Notice how big of a difference punctuation has when we read. The Bible says this. Notice how this is said. And Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto you, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. You see where the comma is? Right there, the. You see that? It makes a difference. It's like a statement. Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto you, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. You see how there's a break there? Jesus is, in this quotation, he is just what? What is he saying? Is he saying that you're going to be with me in paradise today? Or is he making a declaration that you're going, that today you have an assurance that you're going to be with me in paradise? Notice when we switch the comma, how big of a difference it makes. And Jesus said to him, verily I say unto you today, shalt thou be with me in paradise. There's a great difference from where the comma's at in the punctuation, how we read it. One, when it's before it, it makes like a declaration that what's happening? That today you're going to be with me in paradise. When you put it after, and when you, as you read it in that sentence, the context says what? That he's just making the promise that very day. Notice how big quotations and punctuation has as you read the Bible. So that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. Notice this. According to this, the first comma is where? It's after what? It's after aprons. So apparently, if you read this with the punctuation, there were sick handkerchiefs and aprons. How many of you have ever met a sick handkerchief and an apron that were just coughing? How many of you? No, you didn't meet that. That's why the comma needs to be where? After the sick. Are you with me? Notice this. So that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the disease departed from them. So Paul used handkerchiefs and aprons to perform a miracle upon the sick to heal them. You see how big of a difference commas and punctuation have? Amen? Watch this. I like this example. All right, this fits perfectly with me. Let's pretend you're getting married. Let's pretend I'm getting married, because I am, all right? And let's say Abby says, David, I found the perfect dress in England. Really? I need to go out there. I mean, I just saw it online. I need to see it for myself. This is just a must-have. I'm like, all right, I'll get you a ticket to go to England. She goes over to England. She's out there. She finds it. She tries it on. She's like, David, this is the most amazing dress I've ever seen. And I'm excited because she's happy. I'm like, all right, cool. How much does it cost? And she says, David, it costs $10,000. One person, mercy. I guess all of you already spent that much. I don't know. $10,000. And I write a text, so I send her back and I say, no price too high. That's what I say. I write her back on a text message, no price too high. What is she thinking right now? This guy loves me. He really wants to marry me. He is saying there is no price too high. Wow, this guy loves me. But you know, it was my fault because I forgot to put the comma right there. If I put the comma right there, it makes a world of a difference. Are you with me? What is that saying? No, price too high. If I put it over here, if I forget it, she thinks, man, this guy's in love with me. $10,000, here I go. Exactly. Commas make a big difference. Punctuation makes a big difference. So when Jesus said this, he said it after today. Notice, and Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto you today, you shall be with me in paradise. Jesus was promising him that very day that today your salvation is assured. Amen? Well, notice this. Let's take out the commas. If you didn't even get that, it's no problem. I'm terrible at English, all right? My friend Carmen over here knows that. Terrible at English. Did Jesus go to paradise that day? Ah, very good. Let's see what the Bible says. Where is paradise anyway? Notice where paradise at. Revelation 22, verse 1, it says, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from where? The throne of God and of the what? And of the Lamb. In the middle of its street and on either side of the river was the what? So where are we talking about? We're talking about where? Where's paradise? It's in heaven, right near the throne room of God, right near the tree of life. Notice what the Bible says in Revelation 2, 7, to him that what? Overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of what? Of God. So the tree of life, that which is in heaven, that's where paradise is. So paradise is somewhere in heaven. Are you with me? Are you okay? We're all together here. The tree of life is close to the throne of God. Therefore, paradise is where God's throne is. Are you with me? Yes? Okay. Did Jesus Christ go to the throne room with his Father right after he died? Watch what the Bible says. Let's see. Let's see for ourselves. Let's go through the death of Jesus. The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation, that's the Friday, that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was a high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers and broke the legs of the first and of the other which was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, what did they do? They didn't break his legs. All right? So Jesus Friday night was taken to his tomb. There he was. What happened after 3 days? Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday. What happens on Sunday? Resurrection Sunday. And who was there at the tomb? Mary was there. Now notice what the Bible says. This is powerful. Notice this. The Bible says this. Jesus said unto her, Mary, touch me what? Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Friends, on that day when God promised the thief on the cross that you're going to be with me on paradise, wasn't that day I'm going to paradise. But when he was giving him the assurance that you are today, you're going to be with me, is the promise. Today is the promise that you are going to eventually be with me in paradise. Jesus made that promise today. And that thief on the cross died with peace, knowing that soon and very soon he is going to see Jesus again. Amen? Jesus slept for those 3 days. But why did Christ die? This is a powerful thought. Yes, he died for our sins. Yes, he died to save me. But notice one of the other reasons why Jesus died. Such a beautiful verse. I love this verse. Write this verse down. Inasmuch then, as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through what? Death, he might destroy him who had the power of death. That is the what? The devil. Notice this. And release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. You know why Jesus died on the cross, friends? To take away the fear of death. Amen? Let me share with you a story. In 2013, I went to a graduation over in Arkansas. All right, how many of you have been to Arkansas before? Just like four people, all right, yeah. How many of you don't know where Arkansas is at? All right, amen, that's all right. I didn't know where it was at 5 years ago either. It's right next to Texas, on the right of Texas. Anyways, it was May 20 of 2013. Any of you know what was happening around May 20, 2013 in Arkansas, Oklahoma area? The biggest tornadoes our nation ever seen was crossing Oklahoma. And guess where yours truly was? Bright day early in the morning on May 20, I got in the car and I drove with my sister and a couple of my friends. We were all on our way back to sunny California and we were getting to Oklahoma and all of a sudden, it starts getting really dark. And I'm like, man, it's 9 o'clock. What's going on in the morning? Why is it getting dark? All of a sudden, thunder, lightning, rain like you've never seen. And all of a sudden, this lightning came from the sky and knocked down. We're on the freeway. It hit a light post on the freeway. And I'm like, whoa. That's peculiar, man. What's going on? I turn to my friend and say, hey, check your phone. See what's the deal? He checks his iPhone, and then he's looking, and then all of a sudden, I just sense something's wrong. And he kind of taps me, looks over, and says, David, we are in the middle of a tornado. So I'm like, all right, what do we do? Do we drop down and roll? What do we do? Like, I'm from California. What do we do? So we didn't know what to do. So we pulled out of the freeway, and we went up to Lowe's construction warehouse under the hanging that they have there. I don't even know what Lowe's is. Like Home Depot. We pulled underneath there, and we were having lunch. We didn't know what to do. So we're all eating our avocado sandwiches, and we're seeing this great, awesome, like, drama happening right before our eyes. Things are flying everywhere, and we're just sitting there eating. When all of a sudden, someone from Lowe's that's working inside comes out. She sees us there. She's like, ah! And we're like, whoa, what's going on? She's like, you guys need to come inside. We're like, okay. Everybody rushed there, but I made sure I grabbed the rest of my avocado sandwich, and I followed right after. And as I walked in there, we went into this room that was made out of brick, and there was a TV there. On the TV, it showed live the tornado. And the room was packed. It was a small room, but there was like 50 to 75 people there. I could barely eat my sandwich in peace. When all of a sudden, everybody starts getting quiet. And someone says, hey, there goes my bank. Hey, there goes my school. My house. Friends, the tornado was 2 minutes away from us. And everybody's just spellbound. Everyone's scared out of their minds. You know what David did? I continued to eat my avocado sandwich. Now you're sitting here, man, this is a sick man. This is the last time I'm coming to hear this guy. Let me tell you something. When you have Jesus in your life, you don't need to be afraid of dying. I heard a couple amens for that. You know what brings fear when you're facing death? You know what brings fear with the moment that you recognize this may be it, friends? Well, guess what happened? Well, obviously, I didn't die, right? I'm here. The tornado, right when it was about to get us, the tornado lifted up, went over Lowe's, and then landed back on the floor and kept going. But friends, I'm here to tell you that when you have Christ in your life, the Bible says that perfect love casts out fear. Amen? Let me tell you a quick quotation right here. What brings fear? Here it is, friends. Notice this quotation that the psalmist wrote. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no what, friends? Evil. Why? Why isn't David afraid when he's going through the shadow of death? Why isn't David afraid when evil may come upon him? Why isn't David afraid, friends? It's because God is with him. Friends, when God is with you, the Bible says, for neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor height nor depth, nor any other creature can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Maybe tonight you're here, you're sitting down here, and you're thinking about all the loved ones that died, and you're thinking, why, Lord? Why did that person have to die? I love that person. That person was a saint. That person was such a good person. Why did he have to go? Here's this text. These texts are so precious. I hope you write them down. Notice what the Bible says in Psalms 116, verse 15, as we're coming to a close here. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. I mean, this doesn't make any sense. In the sight of God, it is a precious sight to see his dead, those that love him, those that cherish him, those that have a relationship with him. It's precious in his sight to see them die. Why? Well, notice what the wisest man says about it. Notice what he says in Proverbs chapter 14, verse 32. The wicked is what? Is driven away in his wickedness, but the righteous have hope in his death. Friends, when you die, and if you died in Christ, you died with a living hope that you're going to live again. Amen? The Bible says this, why do good men die? Why do righteous women die? The Bible says this in Isaiah 57, one of my most favorite verses. And friends, before I read it to you, I want to tell you this. In 2000, I believe it was in 2012, 2011, my best friend, Derek Lamberte, died. He was only 23 years old. We went to elementary together, junior high together, high school together. He was my best friend. And I remember when his mother called me and she said, David, my son is dying. He battled with leukemia for 7 years. And his mother called me and said, David, my son is dying. I want to tell you something, friends. That very morning when I was spending time with God, before she called me, this is what God told me. In Isaiah 57, verse 1, the righteous perish, and no man lays it to heart. Merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. Friends, when his mother told me that, I was crushed. I began to cry, weep. But I had this blessed hope that my friend lived a righteous life, a good life. And maybe perhaps the reason why God's allowing him to go is because he's taking him away. He's sparing him from the evil that is about to come to this world. Amen? Friends, Jesus Christ is coming soon. Amen? And friends, he's coming soon. And the blessed hope is on that day, we are not just united with our Lord Jesus Christ, friends. We are reunited with those who died in Christ. Yes, friends, it's going to be the most amazing, climactic, most beautiful event, friends. We are going to see Jesus coming in the clouds, but Jesus is going to perform a very miracle in our eyes. I am expecting, by God's grace, to see my friend Derek rise from the tomb. I am expecting, by God's grace, to see my Aunt Yvonne rise from the tomb. I am expecting, by God's grace, to see my grandmother Isabel rise from the tomb, friends. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be here much longer. I don't want to be separated much longer from my family and friends. And friends, the blessed hope is Jesus is coming soon. And he's going to, all the sorrow and pain is going to die. It's going to fade away. But friends, our relationship with our loved ones and our relationship with Jesus would continue to the ceaseless ages of eternity. In 2008, China had this terrible earthquake that killed 69,000 people. And in that devastating earthquake, rescue workers were out and about trying to find if there was anyone that was alive still under the debris of the house's buildings. And as one of the rescue workers was passing by this house, he noticed that underneath the house it seemed like there was someone there, crouched over. So he goes over and he starts moving things around, and sure enough, a person is lying on her knees down to the floor. He calls more rescue workers to come and help. So by brick, wood by wood, they remove the debris. And as they got to the person, it was a woman. They got to her, tried to move her, but she had died. The weight of the house crushed her. But there was something underneath her that was alive. As the earthquake took place, the mother quickly wrapped her baby in blankets, put her underneath her, and took the weight of the house on her back. The rescue workers grabbed the baby, they checked to see if it was alive, they took the blankets off, and the baby was still breathing, friends. They rushed that baby over to some doctors nearby, and as the doctors were taking off the rest of the blankets, all of a sudden, a cell phone fell out. And on the cell phone, there was a last message that her mother wrote to her dying son. And it said this: "My son, if you are alive to ever read this, never forget that I love you." My brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ took the weight of the sins of the world. In fact, friends, he took your sins, put it upon his back, just to let you know that he loves you. Friends, I want to let you know that there is a love that is stronger than death. There is a love that will conquer death. The Bible says, Jesus says, "I have the keys of hell and the grave." Jesus says, "I have the keys that could open up the grave. I have it." But the question I have for you tonight is, does Jesus have the keys to your heart? My brothers and sisters, how many of you tonight want to hand over your life, your heart, your all to the man who showed you the greatest way anyone can, that he loves you? How many of you tonight want to say, "Lord, I want to give you my heart. Death is a scary thing to me because I recognize perhaps that you are not there. That I do not spend time with you in the Word. I do not spend time with you in prayer. And Father, I am afraid even today of dying because I don't sense you with me. But today, Lord, you love me and I recognize that. And I want to give you the keys. I want to give you the keys to my heart. Take away the fear, Father. Take away those sins. Take away the doubts. Father, take away my idols. Take my sins." If you want to give the keys of your heart to Jesus tonight, I want to invite you to stand. You want to say, "Lord, I want you to have the keys to my heart. I want you to take the fear away. I want you to take the sins away. I want you, Father, to give me the peace even when catastrophes are all around me. Father, I want to have the assurance that no tornado, no earthquake can separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Friends, tonight we learned of a love that is stronger than death. And I pray you and I, night by night, will grow more in love with Jesus Christ. Let's pray. My Father, which is in heaven, you see your saints standing tonight, wanting the reassurance, Father, that you have the keys in of our life, that you are the, that your hands are on the steering wheels of our life, Father, that you are guiding, that you are leading, Father, that whatever happens around me, it will never take away from the peace that you give inside me. I pray from my heart, Lord, that no one will leave this place fearful for what tomorrow may bring. That everybody here will leave this place with the assurance that Jesus loves me, that Jesus died for me, and that Jesus will be there for me when I need him the most. Please help us remember what you did for us on that cross. Please help us remember, Lord, that though our family members that we love so much are sleeping right now, are not suffering, are not looking down in this sinful world, they're sleeping, they're at perfect rest, Father. Give us the peace in knowing that one day, I believe very soon, we will see them again. This time, Father, we will not be separated by time. We'll not be separated by sin or death nor anything. But we'll be able to spend with you and them for all eternity. Thank you, God. Thank you for dying on the cross for our sins to take away that fear and give us the assurance that as Jesus rose from the grave, he will cause those to rise from their graves who've died believing in him. Thank you for that blessed hope. Take the keys of our hearts, Father, and guide us closer to you each night. For I pray this sweet prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.